Propaganda is us, Canada. And the propaganda is daily and it's pervasive. And it basically, the point of the propaganda is to emphasize that we are better than America. Less crime, and there's less pollution, and there wasn't segregation, and there wasn't slavery, and there's much less racism. I cannot be oblivious to a history of oppression and of discrimination against various groups that persisted over a very long period of time with consequences that are still with us that cannot be adequately addressed unless we own up to that history. I'm very conscious and very well aware of the history of discrimination and racism, specifically vis-a-vis blacks and natives, the Mi'kmaq population, indigenous people of Nova Scotia, and then the blacks who were brought to Nova Scotia as slaves. And that is how our presence in Nova Scotia began. When black people were brought to Nova Scotia on those Royal Navy ships as a part of the Loyalist exile from the fledgling United States of America, but then also later on as War of 1812 refugees, when they arrived in Nova Scotia, they were settled upon the worst land, land that could not be used for agriculture. There's a long history of a black presence in Nova Scotia, but again, that presence is rooted in labor exploitation. So that if you were black, brown, African Nova Scotian, or to use my word, Africadian, your future was to be a wage slave, to be a poor black laborer for the lowest wages possible, and basically to fulfill unskilled laboring positions in the Nova Scotian economy. Most of these plots of bad land that were given deliberately to black arrivals to Nova Scotia, were also located deliberately as well outside white towns, white villages, or of course inside Halifax, along the shores of Bedford Basin, developing into a community later known quite famously as Africville. And right along with that, there were also laws that some towns passed. For instance, the town of Digby had laws on its books until the 1960s that said if you were black, you cannot own land in town. You cannot own land in Digby Town. And not only that, if you're black, you have to be out of town by sundown. That was a law in Digby, Nova Scotia until 1967. You could not be called to act as a juror unless you lived in parts of Halifax or other places that were basically the enclaves of the wealthy, the middle class, and white. And so it would have been impossible for any black defendant well into the 20th century in Nova Scotia to ever have a jury by his or her peers. Rocky Jones was the greatest black leader, the greatest Africadian leader of the 20th and into the 21st century. He was the one who acted as our local Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, Fannie Lou Hamer, and for that matter, Stokely Carmichael, Kwame Ture. He was all of those people rolled into one man. And at the same time, ultimately, he became a lawyer and actually argued a case before the Supreme Court of this country and a case that he won. Not only was it a victory for Madam Justice Sparks and the fact that she was vindicated, it was a victory for all the whole judiciary. Because that case made the point that it was okay for all judges of whatever background to bring in personal experience in making judgments. Because before that case, it wasn't supposed to be part of your thinking. Or at least you weren't supposed to admit to it in open court that my personal experience had some influence on my decision making about the innocence or guilt of a particular party, a particular defendant. You know, it's better that we understand the ways in which we have misbehaved in the past so we don't continue the misbehavior now or extend it or continue it in the future. I hope I tell the story in many different ways and many different kinds of writing. There are the poems that talk about specific elements of African, Nova Scotian or Africadian history or events and so on. There are the novels that are both my novels so far based on true life experiences. We all have our desires and we all have our aspirations. And whether we know it or not, all of our desires and aspirations are also hemmed in by social constraints and political constraints. And actually, it's good if we do know what they are. And so in researching those stories, I'm also looking into the class and political systems at play at these different times, these different provinces, and in the country as a whole. I think that we could make faster progress and go even further and accomplish more if, in fact, we are aware of our histories and also aware of the ways in which we continue to be subject to marginalization and what I like to call simply subjection or oppression, and so on.